Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning and welcome. Can you hear me? There we go. Good morning and welcome to Valley Bible Church. Why don't you stand up together as we sing, I've come to praise you. We've come to praise the name of the Lord. Amen. He is high and lifted up. We magnify you. Somebody in the Lord. don't you stay standing as we sing, "You Have Made Me Glad." I'll give thanks to the Lord and sing praise to his name on Most High. I'll declare your love in the morning and your faithfulness by night. For you, O Lord, have made me glad. Let's notify our faces this morning. Amen.
In the morning, and your faithfulness, my life.
and you can take all your sins and your griefs and your cares right to him, and he cares for you. What a friend.
Bosworth went on. this morning, her family needs prayer for the other ones left behind. And he said he didn't want us to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep. But we were to grieve as those with hope, not without hope. So we grieve the loss of Linda, but we have hope. We have hope, and so does the family. But I'd like you to, this morning as we pray, I would love it if you could just remember the Bosworths, Greg and Alan and Lori and the rest of the family, the daughter Sherry. Just remember them. They went to bed last night not knowing that they'd be saying goodbye to mom or a wife of, oh, I don't know, Greg and Linda got to have been married at least 50 years. So, you know, take it to the Lord in prayer. Amen? He's a friend. He's a friend. You know what I found out? He's a friend in good times. He's a friend in bad times. And so this morning, we're going to take some time and pray. I want you to remember Don Nason today. He's in the hospital, had a heart attack this last week. Had two heart attacks yesterday. Thought he was getting better. Two more heart attacks. His daughter, him and Sandy and Greg and Charlie Nason are by the bedside of Dad. They might be saying goodbye to you this morning. Might have already said goodbye to him. Don't know. But would you keep him in your prayers? You see, that's the God that I get to go to. I get to go to that God that says, I'm with you from, we like to say from the cradle to the grave. But he's been with me since before the foundations of the earth. There's some kind of relationship that he's had. Because he said, I'm going to want you, which is beyond me. Why would he want me? And some of you would say amen to that. But he did. So he put my name in a book that only he gets to open. Isn't that amazing? And that's you too if you put your faith in him. So this morning, prayer counselor is going to come. And we're going to give you an opportunity to pray. We're going to talk. It's so good to see John Wacker with me this morning, with us this morning at church. John, it's great to see you here this morning. We're praying for you, Stephen. So if you can make your way up for prayer, we would love to pray with you. And I just want to let you know now, we're going to close this prayer session now this morning by having Nathaniel and help me with names here, Kylea and those young ladies that are in the Christian clubs for the, just going to have you guys come up to close this out, and we'll be praying over you, okay? So come if you have a prayer need, a prayer request. Maybe you just want to come and say, I am just so thankful for what God's doing in my life. I just got to praise with somebody and let them pray and enjoy that prayer with you. So pray, church. Please pray this morning. Pray. And so it's really kind of the kickoff of the year for them, and they're getting it going and motivating them going that direction. So what I've done is wanted to have them come up and let you see their faces. And I'm reminded of my high school days. And I never saw me ever being up here doing something like this. Matter of fact, I didn't carry my Bible to school with me. I wasn't part of the Christian club. I was a Christian. I wasn't part of those clubs. But these young ladies have said, we're going to take a stand for Jesus Christ. Right? And I would say this, and then I'm going to have Randy's going to pray over this because I don't want to carry on too long because we'll end up losing a song. I would like to say thank you to Anna Hartano, who has driven. Yeah. She's right here. She shows up to support when we're going to pray for these. But she's been if you've known Anna very long, she pushes for this. She thinks this is important that our high school students get to know Jesus Christ early. So, Randy, would you come and pray over these young ladies and ask God to continue to give them the boldness?
Absolutely. So thankful for you young girls for being bold and unashamed of the gospel. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you put a burden in our heart. You don't just save us and take us right to heaven, but you actually give us good works that you say you planned before the foundations. You give us good works to complete. And I just think of these young ladies that are willing to serve you in a mighty way in public school systems. I also think that it's an open door there, that they're not being rejected. They're not being told no. And they're not facing persecution. Instead, we see droves of students wanting to come to hear the truth of the gospel. So I pray, Father God, that as our surrounding schools are having these different groups that are forming these different Christian clubs, I pray, Father God, that they have the financial needs met. I know that they need lunch on Wednesdays or certain days when they meet. I pray that you raise up believers to support these students. I pray that they're given the right coaches, the right mentors to help them so that they're teaching the word and teaching it properly to minister the word into these students as they make disciples. But I also pray, Father God, that they find churches. And if they're in our community, that they come to this church if they don't have a church, Father God. So I just pray that you continue to do the work that you're doing. I think about how sometimes we can have doubt. Sometimes we're the ones that get in your way. But you tell us in your word that you are the one that's building your church. And the gates of hell will not prevail. And you've raised up some young people. And I think of the book of Daniel. With Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were refusing to bow the knee to false gods and to fall into the culture that sometimes that's the only thing we may know. But instead, they stood for the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we saw how you delivered them. And so I pray that these young ladies have that same boldness to know that there's one that's going to be in the fire with us. We thank you, Christ, for saving us, for rescuing us, and giving us an opportunity to share this hope that we have in Christ. So bless them, fill these Christian clubs, help them to find a church, and you will continue to build your church. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Just stand with us as we sing Waymaker. He's a miracle-working God. We pray that he'll keep doing that he'll keep saving on these campuses of Hercules High, John Sweat, Pinole, De Anza. Save, Lord, we ask.
You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here.
Joel Enriquez, and I'm here to pray for the offering. 2 weeks ago, the pastoral staff let the congregation know about a need by our missionary in Liberia, Kim Smith. He was in a car accident involved that had a hired worker and a hired driver involved, so they're asking for a car. We're going to hold those donations for the end of the service. There's going to be a Bible left out in the front for that. There are many ways to give. The baskets, online, texting, and dropping off the donations at the church office. But before I pray, let me share a few verses about loving in action. In the book of Romans, chapter 12, verses 19 to 14, it says here, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for another day. We thank you for waking us up and giving us breath in our lungs to sing to you. I thank you for being a part of a church that has responded often to the needs of others. Above all, we thank you for the work you did on the cross, paying for the penalty of our sins. We love you, Lord, and we worship you. We thank you for your word that reminds us to love one another, to honor and be devoted to one another. Like you, you put others before yourself. Help us, Lord, to have a heart like yours. You gave yourself to a people in need. I pray for this offering that it reaches many with the gospel, that they would not only know Jesus and come to a saving faith, but that they would learn to obey all that Jesus told us to do. I pray for the giver and those that could not give. I pray that our hearts and lives would be changed to look more and more like you each day. We love you, Lord, and we pray for your blessing for the remainder of the service. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Valley Bible Church. My name is Mia Miranda. If this is your first time at Valley, we are glad you are here. Please fill out the connection card in front of you and take it to the Welcome Center in the lobby after the service. We'd love to get to know you and give you a free gift. Jesus told his followers to go and make disciples, an 8-week Sunday school class for teens and adults called Make Disciples, started today at 9 a.m. in room 104. But it's not too late to join in. Starting next Sunday, come explore Christ's mission for every believer. Valley Bible Church will have a booth at the Hercules Bayfront Run and Festival held on October 6th. If you are interested in running a 5K, 10K, or 1 mile run, register at bayfrontrun.com by September 20th and use the code VALLEY to waive the registration fee. Even if you don't plan on running, come on down, wear your VBC t-shirt, and show the love of Jesus to the community. For details on all the events happening here at Valley, please visit our website at valleybible.org or download our free app. VBC kids, thank you for worshiping with us. You are free to head to your classes as we continue to worship.
Thank you. in case I forget to remind you, there's a Bible offering after the service this morning for our missionary, Kim Smith. I did put the Bible down, so I didn't forget that. But we want to keep that in mind. But good morning to you.
Good morning.
Wow, I am glad to hear alertness. That encourages me. Well, this morning we're going to be continuing our series in the book of Philippians, in our series called Unstoppable Joy. I'm hoping you're having unstoppable joy. There's a lot of things that would want to interrupt that. But beginning here in our verses today, in verse 17 of chapter 3, Paul is going to be providing some practical instructions and practical thoughts on his goal that he's trying to achieve. And what goal was that? That was in verse 14 when we read that he is pressing on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. He's a pursuer of Christ. And we're going to see as he concludes, he's going to give us three practical instructions, lessons on how to pursue Christ and Christ-likeness. One, he'll tell us, follow the right examples. Two, he'll say, avoid the examples of the enemies. And three, set our expectations and our minds on heaven. And so I want to begin by asking you a few questions this morning. And please, these are just for you to ponder. Don't answer out loud. We're not looking for that. But they're all really asking one question. Who do you look to as a role model in your life? Who do you try to imitate? Who do you pattern your life after? Who do you like to spend time with and hang around? Who do you listen to on the TV or on the internet? And if you're a subscriber to somebody's channel on the internet, who do you listen to? In short, all these questions ask, who are you allowing and choosing to allow to influence you? Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:33 that bad company corrupts good morals. Now, put in more common language, we become like those we spend time with and hang around. I mean, every parent of younger kids seems to remember this. They try to keep their kids away from those kinds of influences that would be negative and bad for their children. But we all seem to think for some reason that when we grow older, that this is no longer needed and it no longer applies. Somehow we can listen to what we want, watch what we want, and it will not affect us. The Bible says this is wrong. You will be affected. So this morning, as the influencers that are all around us strive to lead us where they want to take us, let's see what God has to say about who it is we really should be following and imitating and patterning our lives after and being careful to do so. And I invite you to turn your Bibles to Philippians chapter 3, and we're going to read from verse 17 to the close of the chapter. Brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. For many walk, of whom I often told you and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory by the exertion of the power that he has even to subject all things to himself. And this is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this passage. We thank you for Paul's practical teaching. We ask you, Father, to apply this in our minds and hearts and let us understand how easy it is to be influenced by the culture and by those around us without even knowing we're doing it. And help us, Father, to set those examples before our eyes and pattern ourselves after them, as well as be patterns that others could follow that would teach them and lead them to be more like Jesus Christ. Father, would you do that in our heart and mind and help us to fix our eyes this morning, not on the culture, not on the politics, not on our neighbors, but on Christ, and get our marching orders from our King who is in heaven. Help us to do these things today, Father, by your power and your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want to begin by reading a quote from John Newton. It's about everyone who comes in this pulpit. Really profound for me, and I'm just going to share it as I start. Newton said this in the 18th century. "I count it my honor and happiness that I preach to a free people who have the Bible in their hands. And to your Bibles I appeal. I entreat and I charge you to receive nothing upon my word any further than I can prove it from the word of God. And bring every preacher and every sermon that you ever hear to the same standard. May God grant it always be so from this pulpit and in our congregation. May the word of God be what we hold to." Well, as Paul closes out his chapter, he's going to share one of the few autobiographical passages about himself in Scripture. And in it, he describes a man who was aggressively and completely sold out to Jesus Christ and passionately pursuing him. A man who told us, "Hey, you know, I was circumcised on the right day. I had the right religious assets. I mean, I was even a man who was born in the right nation, the nation of Israel. In fact, I was of high pedigree. I was of the tribe of Benjamin. And if you could trace your lineage back to Benjamin, you actually could trace it all the way back to Adam." So he says, "I could trace my roots all the way back to Adam." Anybody here can say that? No, this guy had some unique credentials. And he says that he had studied the law so well, he became a Pharisee, and he was so serious about his faith that he even persecuted and killed Christians, people he thought opposed his faith. But he says this, "I had to abandon," and we just read this in the first part of chapter 3. "I had to abandon all my religiousness, all my fleshly accomplishments, all my merits, everything I had counted on that I could ever be right with God about, and I had to forget it and leave it behind and claim to one thing, knowing Christ in Him alone." And so he says, this is the first step of pursuing Christ and wanting to be just like Jesus said in Matthew 28:20. You know, when Matthew shared that verse and Jesus shared that verse, he says, "Make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey." He didn't say, as we heard before, he didn't say, "Tell them to obey." He didn't say, "Give them a list of things to obey." He said, "Show them how to do it. Show them what obedience looks like. Teach them." And that's what Paul's going to try to do here. You know, if anybody ever tried snow skiing, I'm going to say, if you've never tried snow skiing, all I'm going to do is I'm going to teach you this way. I'm going to give you a 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper typed out with written instructions on everything you need to know about skiing. I'm not going to give you any pictures. I'm not going to point out anything about what a ski looks like. I'm just going to say, this is what you do. How many people would learn how to ski and go to the top of the mountain? We can't do that with the Bible either. You can't just say, this is what it says, do it. Paul says that. He says, I'm going to show you what this is like, and I'm going to give you three practical examples of how you can actually be a pursuer of Christ. If you're confused about what that looks like, let me show you, not just tell you. And so here we dive in. The first thing he said that we need to do to pursue Christ-likeness is do what? He says, follow the right examples. See, this is a tough thing because many of us are following things we don't even know we're following. But he says, be careful to follow the right examples. And he says this, brethren, verse 17, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. I think it's important you stop for a quick minute. Paul starts off with the word brethren. He doesn't waste words. God doesn't waste words. Why does he say this? Because Paul is probably one of the most famous apostles, one of the greatest Christians who's ever lived, and he might think, or we might think, or the Philippians might think, that he's on this guy that's on a pedestal. Nobody could achieve what Paul achieves. No, he's starting it off by saying, brethren, I'm just like you. Brothers and sisters, we're all in the same family. We all belong to Christ. We're all peers. So take Paul off a pedestal and say, when you follow someone like me, you're following a peer. And he also lets us know then we should be able to be examples to one another. You're not looking to the super Christians alone to give you the example. Don't do that. We should be pursuing ourselves to be such models. But Paul takes himself off the pedestal immediately. And that tells us right off the bat when he says, look, I'm no better than you. I didn't die for the sheep. You're not just a bunch of stinky sheep. You're my brothers and sisters. And I think pastors need to do the same thing. Elders need to do the same thing. We got to always remember, we didn't buy the sheep. We didn't die for the sheep. We don't own the sheep. We don't own this congregation. Jesus owns this congregation. And we have to live that way. And Paul said, look, that's part of the example that we must set. When he says, join me in following my example, there's humility right off the bat. So if you don't see humility up here first, then it's not a very good model for you to follow, is it? So we go on. But he says, join in following my example. And you might think, well, yeah, you just told me you're humble. Now you're telling me, follow my example. I got it down. That's not what Paul's saying. He's not some guy on an ego trip. He says this, the words really mean, be fellow imitators with me. When we are all imitating Christ, does anybody do it perfectly? No. Paul's not claiming perfect imitation of Christ. We are not expected to be perfect imitators of Christ in this life. But we are to be moving the direction of imitating him. And what he says here is, imitate me. But this is very transparent. And I don't know many people that I've ever met that would ever say what Paul said for another reason. Paul was basically saying, look, I'm willing to put the movie of my entire life on the screen in front of the church. I want you to look at how I talk, how I walk, how I respond to difficulties, how I respond to trials, respond to my enemies, those that betray me, how I do my quiet time. Watch everything about my life, every word I say, and pattern your life after that. How many here would like me to take a movie of your life over the last week, let's say, every word you said, everything you did, every person you interacted with, everything you looked at, and I put it on the screen? Anybody volunteering for that? We should be ready to volunteer for that. Paul says, imitate me, follow me around, do what I do, not just what I know, do what I do. And we need to be people that are being molded by God to get to that same place, right? And if we can't play the movie of our life on the screen of the church, then why not? And I'm not talking about the personal intimate moments we have as spouses. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about just your life. What you do every day, go to work, driving in the car. Would you like even a video of you driving your car? Of course, we'd have a cutout of your speed down here and a picture of your face up here. No, most of us wouldn't. And we need to be people that are authentic and can be copied. But he says, be imitators of me just as I am of Christ. That's what he said in 1 Corinthians 15:1. How he loved, how he sacrificed, every word. He says, I'm a man in pursuit of Christ, and if you just follow me, don't just listen to what I teach you. If you follow me around, you will know Jesus Christ better. Isn't that what he's calling us to do? Know Jesus Christ better. Imitate my hungry pursuit of Christ. You see, Paul was an imperfect man. But we have if we were only following Jesus, we might be tempted to say, well, nobody could achieve that. But Paul made his mistakes. We will make our mistakes. We're not perfect, but following an authentic Christian, even in the midst of a fallen world, means we'll see how do you handle to a fall, to a stumble, to a mistake, to a thing you wish you hadn't done, to a sin in your life. You mean Christian sin? Yes, we do. Don't act pious. You do. But following somebody who pursues Christ, is how should you respond to that? What should you do in humble confession, in seeking forgiveness, in moving on, and not letting it drag you down, saying, well, I sinned 2 years ago and I can never be used again. That's not following Christ. So Paul says, look, I'm a man that's failed just like you, but you can follow me. And you can even see how do I handle my own failures. That's who we need to be. He says, walk according to the pattern you have in us. And I'm convinced that when he meant us, he meant he and the two people he just talked about in chapter 2, Timothy and Epaphroditus. And he said, these guys were humble, self-sacrificing servants. Timothy said he put things of Christ first, and of Epaphroditus he said he worked so hard in service to others, not for himself, to others, for the cause of Christ, he almost died. He says, emulate this kind of dedication and devotion, putting Christ first, working so hard you almost die because you're working for others, not yourself. This is exactly like Jesus, is it not? He said, I came to seek and save the lost. I came not to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a sacrifice for many. When we are like this, when we are like Timothy and Paul and Epaphroditus, we show we're like Jesus. And that demonstrates our Christ to a watching world. This is why I ask you at the very beginning, who's your model? Who are you following? You know, we ought to act and imitate people that have the things that Paul just talked about. When he talked in chapter 2, he said, have this mind in Christ, right? That's in you, this humble servant mind. I would say that if you're following a humble, self-sacrificing servant to Christ, you're following the right person. You're following someone that will show you Jesus. Knowing that person will make you know Jesus better. He said, second, we should follow someone, like he said later in chapter 3, is I gave up everything I counted on in this fleshly world. No rule-keeping, no credentials of flesh are worth keeping. He says, I don't boast in myself anymore. He told the Corinthians this. He says, look, we didn't come with eloquence of speech or high-sounding educational background. We came in the Spirit's power. What he said in 2 Corinthians 3:5, he says, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy comes from God. Do you hear that? We're not adequate even to do the ministry we do right here at Valley Bible Church. But God makes us successful anyway. Not because we're competent, but because he's awesome. And when we trust him and follow him and imitate him, he takes responsibility for the effects. He takes responsibility for what happens. He causes us to be effective even when we're a bunch of clowns. Why? Because we trust him. Not we count on our own flesh and our own credentials. I'm smart. Listen to me. May it never be in this church. Well, third, we should follow people who are in full pursuit of Jesus Christ, that are not deterred. They're never sidelined. They've thrown away every weight that might hinder their walk. They're in pursuit of Christ. Have you ever tried to follow somebody on the highway and they drive a little faster than you? And you're wondering, how am I going to keep up with that guy? And you're weaving in and out of traffic and you're getting uncomfortable. What's it take to follow? When you know getting lost where you are means really bad things for you, you work hard at following, don't you? Even if they're not a good leader, you try to follow hard. Well, Jesus Christ is a good leader, but he says, follow me, stick with me, imitate me, follow after me, and we should be in full pursuit of anyone pursuing Christ. Anyone that's fully pursuing Christ. You know, I was just thinking about that. Who's a hard worker? Maybe it's somebody working the VBC kids or youth or in worship or taking care of the grounds that we live on, or maybe it's in the ushers or you know, these guys are often below the radar, but they're servants. And they're self-sacrificing servants. If you find one of these people, follow what they do. Do what they do. Don't put confidence in the flesh. Well, let me move on. Because if we're just a bunch of people who are confident in our knowledge, if this pulpit is only about teaching people to know the doctrine, we're a bunch of knowledge people here. If that's what it was, we might as well pack up. Because knowledge without service, knowledge without obedience, knowledge without humility, knowledge without love is vanity and puffs up and is useless. We need knowledge in humble, self-sacrificing service that pursues aggressively after our Savior. That's what we need. Well, how else should we follow? 1 Timothy 4 gives us some clues. It says this, "Let no one look down on your youthfulness, but rather in speech, conduct, love, faith, and purity, show yourself an example." What should you be an example in? And what kind of a person should you be looking for to see an example? You should be looking for someone that says, well, they speak the truth. They don't gossip. They're pure-mouthed. You never hear a coarse joke or a rude word or an off-color innuendo. They're pure-minded. There are no sensuous actions or speech. They're a lover of people, even their enemies. They demonstrate humility in everything they do. They're faithful. Their conduct above reproach. This is who we should follow. This is how you must lead. Not perfect, but if you do make faults, confess them and move on. That's what Paul did. Well, I would ask God to mold you and me and every other person to be not only people who follow after these models, but I would ask you, why are you not this model? Why am I not? Why should you be able to be on somebody's list to say, I want to follow that person. By following them, I will know Christ better. I've heard the question raised before, are there any names on a list you could provide that have shaped you and molded you and pressed you on to Christ? I do. I have three names on my list that come to my mind immediately. One is my dad. I don't want to weep. One's my dad. He's gone. He's with Jesus. But one is my Campus Crusade for Christ director named Randy Rowan. He's also with Christ. Another one is Pastor Phil. You know, Pastor Phil had a way, I don't know if I'll call it a kind way, a good way, but his foot was in my back, and I was being motivated forward. But I was propelled to know Christ better, and I was internally compelled to know Christ better. Because he's perfect? No. But he was pursuing Christ, and I wanted to pursue Christ. I wanted to know him like he knew him. And we have to have people like that in our lives. And I would challenge you, you need to be that person on somebody else's list. Why is your name not on someone else's list? Jesus wants it to be. Well, examples of enemies to avoid. I'm a little behind, but I'll roll. Like the good teacher he is, he not only tells you who to follow, but who not to. In verses 18 and 19, it says, "For many walk, of whom I'm often told you, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things." See, Paul's telling you by the word walk, I think, right off the chute, that he used the word in Galatians many times to say, walk according to the Spirit, not the flesh. Conduct your Christian life. Live a manner of life that's consistent of a Christian. A walk to Paul is how Christians should walk and live and conduct their life. And so I think it's almost clear here that he's saying these people who are enemies are actually inside the walls, not outside. You think enemies can be in the church? You better. Paul thought so. And he says, what is an enemy of the cross of Christ? Well, the cross of Christ was actually the gospel. It's not a wooden cross. It's not an implement of death. It's not, Paul wasn't saying enemies of the cross weren't those that are opposed to the death penalty. What he was saying is they're opposed to God's plan of salvation. And how were they in opposition? They didn't look like they were in opposition. They kind of looked like people who were living Christian lives in their midst. But they're promoting some false teachings that were heretical and damaging and anathema. See, I think Paul was weeping over this. And they were living like enemies. And what's an enemy do? Well, an enemy of the cross generally wants to take something away from the message of the cross, or they want to add something to the message of the cross. I mean, the first option of taking something away were the Gentile false teachers who held to the philosophy of their day, the Greek philosophy of Gnosticism. They were saying, hey, flesh bad, matter bad, evil, spirit good. So salvation wasn't redemption of the body, it was separation of spirit from the body. And so the body was always considered bad. It's always going to be bad. It's bad now, it'll stay bad. So it doesn't matter what you do with this bad body, because it's going to be discarded anyway. It's going to be left behind. So do what you want with your body, because it don't matter, because it's already trash. But your spirit, on the other hand, will go to live. That's an anathema to the scripture. God gave us Christ so that we would overcome sin in our life, that we would not be defeated by the power of sin anymore. We will be one day redeemed from the presence of sin when we go to heaven, but for now, he gave us power over sin through his death on the cross. And for these Gnostics to say it doesn't matter how you live, that was an affront to the gospel. They took something away. Holy living isn't needed. Yes, it is. It's still needed. But what did the other enemy do? Well, they were the Judaizers. They claimed the gospel was good. It was okay. But it was insufficient alone to save. You needed circumcision too. You needed to watch your diet too. You need to keep the law too. But if you did both, you could be saved. You could know God. That's an anathema. Christ is not enough. What kind of a statement is that? See, and anybody who promoted these gospel messages, either get rid of some things like holiness isn't needed, or that you need more than the cross of Christ to be saved, Paul said, they're living as enemies to the cross of Christ. Don't follow them. Don't imitate them. Run. And I think it's interesting that when Paul says that these people would be destroyed, that meant to suffer eternal loss. He wasn't kidding around. He wasn't saying that their arguments are going to fall apart. He says, no, at the end of time, these people are going to hell. They're going to the lake of fire. These are going to be eternally destroyed. Anybody who believes and participates and promotes these heresies are lost. Well, the Jews came in taking pride in circumcision, dietary laws. They were glorying in what should have not been their glory. Their glory should have been Christ, not their works, not their religious actions of circumcision. In fact, those things should have been private. The word actually there, I thought was interesting, is really meant nakedness. And I think Paul was describing to the Judaizers that your private parts that you might want to circumcise have no business being anywhere on display and have nothing to be claimed as something to be boasted about before God. He said, I gave all that stuff up. And that's why he told them, it doesn't matter what you eat, what you touch, your religious actions. Why? Because in Colossians 2, he says, if you've died with Christ, why do you submit yourself to decrees such as do not handle, do not taste, do not touch? Do you know how many Christians today still are wrapped up in what they do and do not do, not in the cross of Christ? It's sad. I want to weep with Paul. Christ came to set us free from the power of sin. And that's why he says, should we keep on sinning that grace may abound? May it not ever happen. Don't let that happen in your life. He says their glory is their shame. Really, they were glorying in those things that they should have been ashamed of. We don't get right with God because of our righteous actions. You know, the church that I grew up with was a nice church, conservative church, but they would have strongly supported the poster I once saw at that time that says, I don't smoke or chew or go with girls who do. In fact, if they had seen you smoking in the parking lot, they would have assumed you weren't saved. Where did that rule come from? Is that in Scripture? No. What does it take to be saved? Religious rules following people's expectations? No. See, what happens is every group, every denomination has their own set of rules that means that you're in the club. And it's unfortunate. And it might be things like holiness. I mean, I don't play cards. I don't go to movies. I don't listen to that nasty rock and roll. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I went to church 3 times every week at least. And I gave more than 10% of my money. I'm at every prayer meeting. These are not substitutes for knowing God. This will not help you know God better. Be all the rule following you want. Paul says these people are opposed and enemies of what he said because it's not by religious rules. It's not based upon what man efforts can do. It's based upon the cross and the cross alone. We will never be made right by following a bunch of church rules. So if you're here and you've never heard this message, I want to share some things with you. I want you to know that you don't have to know what I know or know what he knows or act like me or dress like us or speak like us or learn some secret handshakes. The only thing you need to know, you don't need any religious rules to know God. You need to put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ alone, directly, not through the church. Amen. We're not a middleman. Directly to Jesus Christ himself, and he will rescue you. It's his promise. That's his promise. Faith in God alone is our only guarantee that charges will never be brought up against us in the court of heaven again. This is why Paul said in Romans 8:1, therefore there is now no condemnation for who? For those who are in Christ Jesus. And how do you get in to Christ Jesus? No one gets in by being religious. No one gets in by following rules. We only get in by turning from our sins, placing complete trust and reliance in the Lord Jesus Christ, his substitutionary death on a cruel cross, paying for my sin debt. That's how I get into Christ. That's how I get into heaven. That's how I have no condemnation. That's it. So he says, be careful of church people, no matter what they say, if they're saying something that either adds to or takes away from the gospel of Christ. Run. Run. I love what the hymn writer said. His name was Augustus Toplady in 1776. I think he got it right. His third stanza of his hymn, Rock of Ages, said this: nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Lamb of God, I come. This is it. All you need is the cross of Christ to be saved. That's it. You don't need the church. You don't need me. You don't need our rules. You don't need a secret handshake. You need nothing but Jesus. Nothing but Jesus. Well, last, we want to set our expectations on heaven. Verse 20 and 21, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory, the exertion of the power that he has, even to subject all things to himself. Paul wraps up here with a key focus. He says, even if you're following the right examples, even if you're not following the wrong examples, you need to have the right mindset through it all. And what is that mindset, Paul? He says, remember, your citizenship is in heaven. What does that mean? Is he saying, we got to keep our mind off of earthly things? If you're focused on how good it is here, you're not going to be really ready to live the Christian life. Paul wasn't focused on earthly things. His life was not the life of ease and comfort. He signed off on all those things. If you want to read the verses, I put them in your notes. 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians 4, 8 to 10, and 2 Corinthians 6, 4 to 10. He said, look, as servants of God in much endurance, in afflictions, in hardships, in distress, in beatings, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in sleeplessness, and in hunger. Who wants to sign up? Paul had already signed off on the comforts of life. He says, following Christ, I have to have my mind set on heaven. And I don't look around me. But he says this, our citizenship is in heaven. We must live. See, Paul was reminding these Corinthians, these Philippians, who were a colony of Rome. To be a colony of Rome really meant they had special status with Rome. They were considered citizens of Rome. Anybody born in Philippi was considered just as much a Roman citizen as someone born in Rome, Italy. And as a result, all their clothes looked like Rome. All their architecture looked like Rome. All their, you know, all their language, the Latin looked like Rome. Everything was like Rome. It was a mini Rome. And he's saying, in the same way, don't fix your attention on your citizenship here. We're not proud we're Americans. We should be proud that we're Kingdom of Heaven citizens. Kingdom of Heaven is our real citizenship. Yeah, we might have dual citizenship. Yeah, we're also, this land called America give us a passport. But our eternal passport is stamped with heaven. You have to remember, we don't follow the culture of America. We follow the culture of our real passport of heaven. We don't follow the rules of earth. We follow the rules of heaven. We don't see what's important to earth. We follow what's important to heaven. And that's what he's saying. Look, you're citizens of heaven. Don't take pride in your earthly citizenship or status. It's nothing. Focus on your heavenly citizenship. Because if you do, you'll have the right mindset to live this life and let these things go and to take the hardships of life. Following Christ is not easy. It never will be. Who expects it to be easy? It's not. It's fun. It's not easy. It's exciting, but it's hard. This is what we have to do. We have to value where we're citizens. And you know, I'm tired of people arguing in the church world about they call it the return of Jesus Christ. It's an event they talk about. Is it premillennial? Is it postmillennial? You know, friends, we're not waiting for an event. We're waiting for a person. This person is Jesus Christ, our King. And he's coming back to this outpost, this colony of earth in Hercules. And one day he's coming back. And we should be looking for him, like, eagerly waiting. Is he here yet? Is he here yet? I mean, anybody ever waited for someone that was gone a long time and you really could hardly wait for them to get home? You're looking out the window. Are they there yet? This is how we're supposed to watch for Jesus. He says, look, if you have that mindset, you're going to do better in following Jesus, to be more Christ-like, to be ready to be a servant that humbly self-sacrifices because your eyes are on Jesus. Well, he says we're going to have a body that will be conformed. Our lowly, humiliated body will be transformed. This is hope. Don't worry about how bad it is right now. Could be terrible. Could be sad. But we're going to have a body that will never age, become ill, die. I mean, the longer I live, I realize I'm looking forward to more and more to the return of Jesus Christ. And don't think it's all because it's all spiritual. I'm getting older. Things hurt. The body doesn't work like it used to do. My brain doesn't work as sharp as it used to be. My mind keeps writing checks my body can't cash. I'm ready for a new body. And I'm going to have one just like my Savior. When he came out of the tomb, he had a new body. And we're going to have one just like him. He says, look forward to that. This will help you focus on Christ. Don't worry about the pain of this life. Don't worry about the culture of this life. Don't look around for your comfort. Look to heaven. Look to heaven. Well, besides our body being renewed, our sin nature will also be like Christ. It'll be gone. We won't even want to sin anymore. I can hardly wait. I can't even believe what that'll be like to not have bad thoughts anymore. thoughts that are not honoring and glorifying to my King. We're in bodies now, folks, that are aging, frail, sad, miserable, groaning. God is going to get us out of the groan. Did you know that? One day, he says, look ahead. Your citizenship is in heaven. Your King is soon coming. Your body will be transformed. Look up. The groan will be over soon. Look for Jesus. When you're looking for Jesus, you're not worried about what everybody else is doing. It's easy to let things go. You can live as an example and being an example and following an example, pursuing Christ-likeness. And it'll be fun because you can see the destiny and the destination ahead. Well, let's just go. I want to close here. The hope that Paul is describing is wonderful. And I look forward to being with Jesus. I look forward to it. So to me, the future is optimistic. Is your future optimistic? Is it? Because the future is not so optimistic if you do not know Jesus Christ. Your future has no reason to be optimistic. In fact, it's not very good at all. You have something to look forward to that's called eternal lostness, separation from God, all that is good, pain and darkness. We don't mention it very much from up here. I'm not sure if that's good or bad. It's sad to talk about because it's real. It's right here in Scripture. One could say we don't mention hell quite enough. The Bible tells us that men and women separated by God by sin and who have not placed faith in Christ will suffer a Christless eternity in the lake of fire. Did you know that that's what this word says? It's true. If you don't know Jesus this morning, you don't have hope. But I plead with you, if you're here and awake, you have hope because it's still not too late. You can flee to Jesus. You can flee the wrath of God. You can flee your sin, and Jesus will receive you. He loves you right where you are and all your mess. He loves you. And he's saying, come, take my forgiveness. Accept the price I paid for you. I want to rescue you. I want to rescue you. Will you let me rescue you? Then you will have hope. See, believers have hope. In a twinkling of an eye, our bodies will be restored. It says in 1 Corinthians 15, it'll happen like that. We won't even have time to blink. But if you don't know Christ, it's not so good. Child of God, be of good cheer. There's nothing to worry about in this life that this destiny will not just wipe out from your memory forever. Jesus might come today. Do you believe that? Today. You ready? Well, this is part of Paul's hope. And he's saying, I look forward to the day I get to stand in the presence of my Lord in my glorified body. This is the prize I'm looking for. And if you run this way, you will pursue Christ-likeness just like me. But I ask if it's going to get better for you today or get worse if Jesus came right now. For those who don't know him, it's going to get worse. But if you're here today and you're not a believer, I sadly can say you're not going to be changed in the twinkling of an eye. You're not going to have hope. You're not going to have a new body to stand in front of my Jesus. It will be terrible. You will be cast outside where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. I don't want that for one person in this room, or actually one person in this world. I would encourage you. I'd implore you. If you hear this message and you say, I don't know that I want Jesus to come back right now because I'm not ready, be ready. Right now, God's talking to you. Right now. Now. This is the time. Listen to him. There's nothing in your world that's going to be more important. There's no football game that's coming up, no lunch that's more important. than you understanding and putting faith in Jesus Christ. Nothing. Not money, not job, not relationship, nothing. And I leave you with this, child of God. Please make it your goal to not only imitate Paul and Timothy and Epaphroditus, but find a model even in this church of a humble, self-sacrificing servant poured out in service to Christ, pursuing Christ, talking about Christ, loving people. We need models in our life of how to live this life. And I pray and I implore you, become the model. Get on somebody else's list. May God grant that to this church, that this place would be full of models and full of people who want to pursue them. Father, I am so convicted by this. I'm a guy that I don't know I want the movie of my life put in front of the church yet. Would you make me such a man that's in full pursuit of my Jesus, letting the things of this world be put in the rearview mirror, not pursuing rule following, but knowing my Savior. Father, may this be a place that people could come into and say, I don't know about all their rules, but I know they love Jesus. I know they want to follow Jesus and obey him. I know they love one another. I don't know about all the rules, but I know they know God. May this place forever be that kind of a place, Father. May Valley Bible Church be changed by your Spirit's power, that we all would become models or followers so that we might know Jesus Christ better and better and better. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I would say, there's a Bible down front. I did remember. Please remember our missionaries. And if you have put faith in Christ this morning, if God talked to your heart, please come down front. Please come talk to me. Come talk to the elders. We want to know. We want to show you how you can put faith in Christ. We want to be teachers like Paul. We're not just going to tell you what to do and send you home. We'll show you how to do it. Come on.